Hey, it's Jerry at the Fledge. Welcome to another episode of Every Damn Day. Today on the show, somebody I'm really excited to have, Mr. Ryan Holmes. How you doing, Ryan?
I'm doing well. How are you doing, man?
I am doing great. I wasn't sure if you were going to show up, you know, shooting us with rays and trying to get me to come in your studio or whatever happens with the Ghostbuster thing.
You know. It's just so expensive every time you fire one of those things off. You know, if I can just come on normally and just use regular broadcasting, you know, it saves us money.
So, man, it's windy out today.
Yes.
Is that affecting what your plans were for the day?
It moved me earlier. Sundays, like all my Ghostbuster shorts that I make, I like to make them on Sundays. Usually it gives me Saturday to recuperate and come up with ideas. And then I wake up literally probably a half an hour before sunup because I can use that time when the sun's coming up if I want to be the sun going down as far as film is concerned. Mm. And it just gives a lot more character in the sky and stuff like that. So I was up right before it, but I was watching the the rain come in on my car going. I was like, no, come on, because you can set up so much over the camera at the same time you have to set it, and I like to get a lot of different angles, so I'm always moving it anyway. You don't want to work against the elements too much, you know.
Yeah. So I pulled this way ahead too quick. You're super famous in mid-Michigan. I think so. And we'll talk about that more, but maybe my friends in Dubai or whoever, that are watching my show from time to time, why don't you tell us a little bit about Ryan Holmes and lead us back into what you're talking about with your Ghostbuster shorts?
Yeah, man. I am a artist, a educator, a placemaker, a creative, a filmmaker of sorts, and Ghostbuster, which and all of them intertwine in this crazy life and city of Lansing. So, I've been pursuing art my entire life since the age of 5, and in turn, in doing that, I've been able to grow as an artist. I use that to help enhance my community. I started, I don't know if I ever told you this, but back in the day originally, art was taking me, or I wanted to take me into the direction of conceptual design for movies, and I wanted to do like comic book sequential art type stuff, graphic novels, and really a mixture between comic book stuff and really the movie industry stuff, because I was really I really loved the fact that you could do conceptual art and what you drew could make it into the movie. It could be made into props. It could be made into the scenery. It could be made into action figures. Like, I wanted to be the guy who made that stuff. So going into school for that, at the same time, finding love for education. In high school, I started working childcare. I started working with kids. So
where was your high school?
Waverly. I went to Waverly Schools. I moved to Lansing in about second grade. So I was a Michigan kid from second grade on, but grew up in Waverly and was started summer before my senior year at a child care program, and did really well with it. My boss was like, hey, you want a job? You're, you know, high school, you know? And so but my senior year, every day after school, I walk over and do their after school program. And then it spun into me just putting a little bit more education into the courses I took, and doing some parapro subbing. And as I was going to school to try to be, or as I ended up going away to Chicago for a year and a half to do a media arts animation program, and got closer to the side of it, the whole graphic design side, well, not graphic design, but actually a lot of the stuff that they were doing right then was being integrated into Cartoon Network and Adult Swim and things like that. And I came with like a real pure message that I was like, I'm going to make these shows. And then it had like this heart to it. I wanted to do it for my kids. And it just, I saw how quickly my original vision would be diluted in the world. And I also was a big self-learner before I went away to Chicago. So I was learning more from the students than I was the teachers while I was there, as I was making relationships, like kind of just like dipping in, you know, kind of like what you see at the Fledge all the time. And we're just like a community of artists, like, hey, how are you doing? What are you doing? You know, and I was having more a community than that, than the educators who were trying to tell me stuff and holding off from telling me stuff and make, you know, it just wasn't working. So I ended up coming back home and pursuing education more. Ended up in working in the Waverly School District, for almost, I want to say, 15 to 16 years, starting up from my high school and then moving on, doing multiple years in special needs as a special ed parapro for emotionally impaired, for maybe 3 or 4 years, same with physically impaired, doing kindergarten, well, pre-kindergarten through eighth grade, multiple years at different grades, just the gamut. and at the same time, doing art and being creative, growing in my craft as an artist, obviously working with the kids that I was around when I could, trying to put it in the programs I was putting it in. In the summers gave me a little bit more time to do more with that. I put together some smaller summer art programs, and then eventually, I want to say, geez, Jerry, was it like 2-3 years ago we met up for the first time and tried this?
Yeah, I think we did it in Lansing, right? So yeah. It would have been about 2.5 years ago.
Yeah. You know, so I put out there feelers being like, I want to do this art. I want to do an art lesson. I want to do programs, and I want a place that would work well for it. And everybody, all fingers, all, it was, you were going to be the guy. So I got in touch with you. I want to say the first year we got, like, I had some kids, but I mean, it was some days, some weeks we had, you know, 3 or 4, some weeks we had 0. And it was like, I didn't know who was going to be there. And I had gotten to the point where, the summer I was working less. So, you know, it was like, this is going to be great. As I planned it out, and I had a lot of interest, but I just didn't get the same amount of numbers, that showed the interest. And, I don't know, just through precision and figuring out through the next year, everything I was doing and working on, by the time I got to the next summer, I've got multitudes more numbers. Like I had about 20 or 30 signed up, but week to week, you know, you had at least 15 or so, because people signed up ahead of time for the whole summer experience, the whole program. And it gave me a chance to add and put a community service aspect and bring in all these different people who helped the program, as far as just giving some things and the opportunities for the kids that were awesome. But it really showed me, like, that was like, what to me, one of the best summers of my life. And it was just because of how I got to engage and put art into their lives, watch those kids in the community as I was going through different things in our like Scrap Fest, or, you know, seeing those different kids out and how they were engaging in art and seeing what I could really do with placemaking. And lo and behold, that same summer, the end of that summer, I was offered a job at Mid-Michigan Leadership Academy as an art teacher. And like, it was like a prayer answered, because it's like, I always say it's like, it was the endless summer. Cause I was like, if anything changed, I just want to keep teaching art. Like, I want to keep this progress going, or process going. And, you know, all this happened the same year also that I won the City Pulse Best Visual Artist for the Top of the Town. And, you know, it was, that was allowing me the dynamic to travel through different communities. The Waverly's become diverse over the 17 years or so that I went through it. I had never really stepped into a room and taught 20 or 30 children that looked just like me before, until that experience, until I won that program and some of the places I got to go teach. And that just like opened my heart to like, wow, there are so many kids who haven't gotten this experience. And So it was just another reason for me to really want to take the opportunity and grow and learn. So this is year two in this program that I've been working, and it was the first year ended in a most spectacular way. So last Friday was Friday the 13th, the Friday the 13th before that was the day we were told that we were going to be shutting down because of COVID, and we thought we might come back in a month or 2 months. The little we know, it was going to be a little bit different. But yeah, that kind of that made the pivot happen. So I don't know. Go ahead.
Well, just those first two summers that you were here when you were doing that, and you had your projector, you had it down, you had it up on the screen. And I think about that often when I think about you teaching your classes online. The pivot, I mean, you were already close to being able to do that. I mean, you could have done that very easily.
Yeah.
Right? You know, and just broadcast everything. So this third summer, when you went that route, I was thinking, are you going to have your kids or your mom or something? I swear during the show. So anyways, I was thinking, fuck yeah, man. Ryan is killing it. Sorry.
Yeah, no, you're good. You're good. No, but seriously. No, but I had that goal that I was used to. Yeah, the summer was going to be a time that I was going to be with my kids. I had just started building those relationships with the kids I had from the year before. Was looking forward to getting back in with them. I hadn't finished my first official year in the building as an art teacher, which was a big thing in my head, that because those were a lot of other relationships that it took me about half the school year with those kids to find a dynamic where I understood, I came in with this, like, here, I'm this award-winning artist that you guys, ta-da, I'm your new art teacher, and this is going to be the show, and you guys are going to love this. And they're like, we don't really care about that. We're looking for somebody to care about us. We're looking for somebody who will want to know about our relationships, what we need, and kind of all my knowledge, it didn't matter. And I had to learn how to build relationships with them and build a place where they could be open and create openly, feel safe, feel inspired. And a lot of that wasn't gonna come from me telling them about my story, but just giving them a place where they could just like create their own. That was broken. I couldn't be there to create that, but I had dabbled in creating YouTube videos, because usually when we have a lot of snow days or something like that, I'll get on and I'll read a book to the kids, or I'll do a quick how to draw video. So I had enough know-how on what was on my computer to start it. And taking that, I just knew I did my first how to draw video literally that first Monday that they didn't have school, and I started right then and there. And that's kind of why things took off, because I was like, a first responder. There was nothing else. What do we do? We have all my kids here. So I laughed because my first video was like 30 minutes, and it didn't have to be 30 minutes to me to draw this thing. And I've learned since how to edit and cut down. I can teach in 10 minutes and then, fast forward some things. But it was that 30 minutes, and it was a relief. And I think at that time, 30 minutes was perfect, because parents kind of needed that 30 minutes. But it was just drawing Baby Yoda. And my idea was real simple. I was going to come up with something that was quick, that everybody kind of was into. I was going to keep the zeitgeist. There's this thing that I do with when I drew at the tin can. I drew something that was already in the public conscience, that everybody was kind of thinking about, make you smile. So take that, and it's like, instead of me drawing it, I'm going to show you how to draw something like that. I'm going to get your kids' attention. Learning is going to be fun, and it's going to be consistent. And taking that as my main focus and doing it every day, I caught a beat, and I kind of, first off, the parents who were doing it, they would, you know, put their pictures up, and I just naturally would put a message, hey, great job. You know, just I would take pick one thing specifically about the picture, you know, great coloring, you know, and the response that the parents were giving me within the first week of doing that, I had two new stations at my house, which was really funny because that was also two new stations trying to figure out how COVID was going to work. So, like, as they came in, they were like, we can't touch you, you know, trying to figure out where to have the interview. And so that was really fun. But the gist that, you know, wow, thank you for doing this kind of, and it was really big. And so as an artist, there's always this process, and we never feel like what we're doing is good enough. And I knew that with the engagement wise, like, I wanted to keep it fun. So, you know, I end right now, well, not end, but right now I have about 84 videos within the first.
So what's your channel? How do we find that channel?
Ryan Holmes Art, or you can search Ryan Holmes Art on YouTube, how to draw Ryan Holmes, or Ryan Holmes, how to draw either one. I don't have a video on how to draw me yet, but that's probably going to come in.
And I'll put a link to it after we're done today.
Awesome. But yeah, like, and so, you know, in the first few, you know, it's like you kind of have your intro, and I started kind of being more fun with my intro, kind of getting and learning the editing system more, finding out some special effects, so working in some jokes. But it became like in the first 30 seconds, if I could blow myself up, catch something on fire, you know, something that make a kid laugh, then you knew you had it. And then just increasing that, learning more about the craft of making videos, life self-learner. So, you know, mic improved, camera improved, you know, learning about the editing programs, adding more effects. My camera system right now is not like that because I have that in my actual classroom, you know, cause I had to end everything transitioned into there. But you know, I was just learning more and more into the fact I got to the green screen and started learning how to use green screen and stuff like that. But I always tell people there's a world where COVID never happened and I never learned any of this stuff. And I never realized that half of it was already on my computer in the first place. Or, you know, and or that the half of it was a couple of free programs and YouTube training and, you know, Amazon shipments away. So, it was a refinement. And, you know, the Ghostbuster stuff, I'm a huge fan of Ghostbusters, and in turn, I'm a part of a coalition and actually a leader of a Lansing group, a Lansing chapter. So as part of that, I've had like a vehicle and the uniform and the proton pack and all the gear. So if you're making a movie, that's automatically like you have half of the props, you know, ready. So I started making Ghostbuster shorts in between making the drawing videos because those pushed me forward in special effects. So I got to learn more how to use a green screen. I could do more with, you know, the lightings and just adding things. So every time I did one of those, it would seem like it was for fun or whatever else, but really I'm just self-teaching and on a bigger scale so I can go back and make the drawing videos more fun. It's just a weird bounce. Like, I just, boom, what, all summer, you know, and the videos grew, the range grew. I started posting them in social groups. So, or not social groups, but I should say social educational groups. So I found different, there were
homes. I wasn't sure you wanted to talk about some of your posts in God is a Pterodactyl.
Yes, man. And but that's it, man. Like, literally, no, you want to talk about No Child Left Behind? Like, this is No Child Left Behind. Like, I'm going there. I'm going to the homeschoolers of Michigan, like, all three regions of Michigan have their own homeschooling groups. I'm going there. I'm going to Delta Township finding happenings. I got a message from somebody in Amsterdam who was using the videos to learn how, or using in the videos, it was a teacher in his class to help teach English. So like,
it was just, nice.
Yeah. So it was weird. And now if you go on, my subscribers consist of a lot of like students and stuff moving back into the school year because it's become part of my class regimen as something they could do online. But it was weird how many people it reached before it got to them or as it was getting to them. You know, but yeah, it's just been a crazy ride.
So, you know what, is that something you do every damn day, is refine that, you know, that's the name of the show. So I always ask that question. What is something you do every damn day that pushes your mission forward?
Yeah. That is, unfortunately, you know what, I wish I could say the video making. When during COVID, I was actually trying to do something with it every day. I probably will think about it every day, but really just focusing on my education or my students in the classroom. Like today is Sunday, and once I'm going to get out of here and go into the room and work on setting up for Monday a little bit, but I have a tendency to not be fly by the seat of my pants, but understand that with creative process, I can be a step ahead sometimes. So I won't put as much time in, like, I'm just like, oh, I'll get it, you know, like, and I don't put as much time in overall, but the kids have broke me of that and have shown me like the opposite of where, if I put more time in on the other end, if I keep refining and just am always kind of someone in a moment with them, I'm able to just do so much more. So, you know, there's always like, I'll go somewhere. I'm an antique or like a thrift shop person, and I'll go somewhere now and I scan an aisle like yesterday, not at work, but I scanned the aisle first and it was like, what I go for. And then I walked away and I walked back and then I scanned out for my kids in my room. And it wasn't the same scan. And I'm learning that, like, to have that mindfulness of like what will be the best for what they're looking for right now and listening to their voices. So I'm always trying to move stuff forward, wherever it's like getting stuff for the room, putting the room together in a certain way, listening to what doesn't work. Or just being mindful and being with them every day, the days that I am with them, and growing with them. We are just trying to create a cauldron, a dynamic. My room is an open lab, a STEAM lab. So we're supposed to be pushing sciences and science and art together. And I'm pushing into engineering and robotics and a lot of different concepts and ideas, but it's fun because they're all in one room. So you have this area where you have painters and at the paint table, but then there are robotics people driving robots around their feet, you know, and it's not, you know, and they're engaging with them. And then they, you know, they drive back by, but you have some people working on DC motors, trying to get those started. And then in the back room, we have some people doing, bracelet design, and teaching each other how to make bracelets and doing self-teaching. And you have somebody in the back doing, some, you know, shoe design or drawing some type of graphic design on the light boards, but there's just like overall calm, or like this is overall, we're used to seeing it in maker spaces, but showing kids that they can have it at all ages. It's so fun to kind of set that up and be mindful of, okay, sometimes I go, you know, I don't know how to use these rubber bands to make a bracelet, but I'll just get them anyway. And then I'll bring them in and go, hey guys, I got these rubber bands. People said that you could make a bracelet out of them. And they're like, oh yeah, we know how to use those. I'm like, okay, cool. Just could you teach me, you know? And it's great. Like they're every day, like, I try to step back and find something where I sit down and let them be the leader. And our goal is, we always say that the smartest person in the room is the room. So, you know,
I like that a lot.
Yeah, it's really good.
So the crowd out there is saying, for young and old, you're an inspiration to all. This is Chris Pruitt, and great hearing more of your story, and keep up the good work. And thank Lady you. Miss Betty, she's giving you a shout out too. Sean is. And so you just talked about your kids for 25 minutes. And you kind of warned me you would do this. Are you working on an art piece that Ryan Holmes is working on for Ryan Holmes?
Ryan Holmes, yeah. And it's funny. That was one thing COVID also taught me too. I was so used to going to the Tin Can. I drew there for, golly, I want to say 6 or 7 years, every Friday night, sometimes Saturday night, sometimes Wednesday nights. But 400 or 500 pieces later of chalk, none of them are still around.
And super amazing art too.
Yes.
And it has this like Dadaism thing. It existed and now it's gone, and maybe it existed and maybe it didn't. And
it's beautiful because it exists in Lansing's zeitgeist, Lansing's aura, because you know, I always know that there's that lifespan of the board getting erased, but there's everybody who was there that night, the pictures that they take with them, or the, you know, it used to be every Friday. So there was this like timing of Saturday morning, people waiting to see what it was going to be, and how, you know, being able to chart what was going on in the world, whether it was, you know, remembrance pictures or, you know, something new coming on Netflix, but just all that. But in turn, it is part of a catalog that, like I said, I have prints that I make of some of the things, but it's kind of, I don't have that consistent, hey, there's not 400 pieces in a warehouse or 400 pieces around the world. So COVID, not being able to go out, really taught me to just sit and make things for myself and slow down in the process, because that was also a performance art to me. You know, that's 3 or 4 hours on your feet in front of, you know, people in and out. So you're going to try to get done within that night. Within my last few years, or actually probably my last year, I started getting comfortable with walking away from a piece and coming back the next day. But COVID like was like, hey man, you can work on something for like 2 days. Hey man, you can work on something for a month. And like, you don't even gotta tell, nobody's got to know what you're doing or anything. So it just, I have a few paintings that, I love movies. So I have a few movie inspired paintings that are very intricate watercolors that I'm, one is, from Aliens. It's of Ripley. And then there is another piece that I started, I don't even remember which one. Oh, I have a couple Star Wars ones that I've been doing. And it's just like, I'll do them when I get done. They're not, maybe I'll do prints for sale, but they're for me. And I'm really enjoying this, like taking my time on them. I'm really enjoying making sure the color matching is right. And just getting like the ambience of what I love about those movies, the essence in those paintings. But yeah, just learn how to take some me time, man, and make some things that are going to last, you know,
You know, I think about what you said, that kind of aura of Lansing. It's in our collective unconscious, that this Ryan Holmes thing. I mean, I think you put a mark, you know, like I might make a mark in a couple photos that my building shows up in or whatever, but like you are there. It made it stronger to have it not exist anymore. It's more resilient. Yeah. It's more,
And it's also, it's funny because all the time I'll catch, you know, if you like, as an essence, we'll keep calling this as essence. I catch myself in Facebook pictures all the time because people will take pictures in front of the boards. So I'll just kind of be scrolling through Facebook and I'll stop and go, oh, hey, I remember when I drew that, you know, and it's become a backdrop for, you know, people's lives. And, you know, they'll remember I met my wife the night you drew this picture, or I met my, you know, me and my best friend were there and they just come in town, you know, I always love the fact too that originally the Tin Can was a dive bar by choice. Like that's what they would want, you consider them cheap beers, cheap friends. And it's never had that. It's never really been that. But to really, in turn, also change the culture there so that you have this great, you know, these great people who come there who were really all the 9-to-5 crowd. People are nurses and people who work at Sparrow in the hospitals, you know, who get a minute every now and then to unwind, you know, and people who come out just to have a great time and party and enjoy downtown Lansing, you know, to just get all those people there and to be able to have them all coming to look for art. It's not just coming to party, but to be looking at art, have conversations about art, enjoy art the way that this just as a cultural that tilt that it took there was so crazy to me, and to watch that over so many years, and I drew the Mona Lisa 7 years ago or 6 years ago. Well, we're in the teens now, so it would have been probably my first or second year there. So we're way farther than that. And I remember drawing it on a chalkboard and going home and going like, man, I'm going to be like famous tomorrow because I drew the Mona Lisa on a chalkboard. Nobody cared, you know, and, you know, 6-7 years later after that, you started writing some articles. But then things start snowballing and I don't know what's going on half the time now.
I've got a somewhere I want to take you. It's yesterday. The person I was supposed to do the show with yesterday didn't show up. So I had to put in one of my shows that I have as a backup. And so the person who would have normally asked you a question didn't ask you a question specifically. So I'm going to use their question that we got from the day before. I'm causing all kinds of confusion. Here's the question. The question was, for her, who was a talent agent, where does she find talent? But what I want to ask you is, where does artistic talent come from, right? Does it, and I don't know if that makes sense. So let's just try, see if there's an answer in there somewhere.
Right. I'm going to take this back around to my kids. And the idea of like, when I spoke earlier about them being very guarded, and even in my own artistic journey, I was 5 when, you know, a teacher kind of pulled me out of class, pulled my mom aside and said I was gifted at art. Before that, I was creating stuff all the time in my house, watching cartoons, drawing off of them, having fun, you know, drawing stuff. But no one had labeled what I was doing. Nobody had told me I was bad at it. Nobody had given me any negative feedback. I feel like creativity, when you have the room to breathe and find your outlets in a healthy way where you can make mistakes, you can learn new techniques, you can just find new things. The way my classroom is set up right now, I always, when my kids come in, I tell them about the room. The room is set up so that I don't have to be present at any area of the room once I've told them about it. And I'm okay with any choice that they might make there. So I put a bunch of paint out, but it's out in such a way that I'm okay with it going anywhere in the area, because I don't want to ever have to come over and say like, what are you doing? How you ruined it. I don't ever want to make or have a moment that destroys a child's ability to engage or want to engage, to want to like go, okay, well, never trying that again. You know what I mean? Well, but never. Yep. That's what I thought. I was going to ruin it. And when you make an area like that, when you have this area, so now my eye, when I look at these kids, the stuff that will happen in my room in a week, I never would have expected. I had, kids airbrushing t-shirts last week in 6th grade. I had a 2nd grader who made a flip book using a light table. Didn't tell him to cut it. Did it himself, made a light table. I had a group of kids create a robotics game where they made a tightrope or they took like a plank of cardboard, put it across two stools, had two robots on each side, and it was a game to make the robots had to go walk the tightrope against each other and kind of play chicken by remote. And then they built like a safe area for it to land at the bottom of it. But like creating an area where they can take these creative journeys and never tell them that they're wrong, only just go, hey, give them, and then just feed them and just go, okay, wow, you know, there's more duct tape over there. You know what I mean? You know, that's really cool. So what happens after somebody wins? You know what I mean? Or man, that's really great. Here are some clips to put just to feed them. And it's, that's where creativity starts. It's the kid who just like, you know, nobody just tells them no for a little while.
Yeah.
And nobody, you know, and when you can do that, and us as adults, when we can step back and go, I know the scissors are kind of sharp, but give them the scissors, like, you know, give them the
scissors. Like, so, a few weeks ago, you were here, I guess at the end of September, because it was called When September Ends, and you were doing some drawings and teaching some kids how to draw from our community, from our neighborhood, and these kids look like you, right? Yes. And I was watching you, and it makes me so happy to see you. Because I see you especially over here. I really missed you this year with COVID and all of that.
I know. It was nice to be there.
Because one of our fears, one of the things that keeps us awake, that keeps us driven every single day, is that we know that genius is lost in poverty, and that we're surrounded by poverty, and we're probably surrounded by genius that might not ever be that genius. And I love, in fifth grade, a music teacher told me I didn't know what the hell music was. And I was like, all right, then I ain't going to do that. And I never did it. And what you're saying really touches me. And then to know that you were doing that out in my front yard at the Fledge a few weeks ago or whatever, man, I love Ryan Holmes being around. I just wanted to put that out there for you, because that is such important work.
Well, it's important to me too, man. It's important, like the community that I want to build. If I can, like right now, give them ownership of what, like you said, that poverty that they have creates a poverty mindset. And when you have a poverty mindset, you only see so many options. Creativity is the key to having more options. If you've only seen people in your family live paycheck to paycheck, week to week, struggle, and only have one or two, three ways to make money, and you know, I mean, they don't know that, you know, like that creativity could be a route, that they don't know that, you know, the ability. That's why we do everything. I have two. It started out as two Barbie heads, two of those Barbie heads that you style. I'm looking for actual style doll heads from a college. I would like actual mannequin heads that you style. We have two heads that my girls and my boys braid and do hair on daily. And the idea is that we talk about that not only is, you know, that style, we do the math on how much a head is for somebody to do hair in a chair. How many people do you have to have sitting in your chair? You know what I mean? We self-teach. You know how to do this braid, teach this person. And they go back and forth. But we integrate that to go, this is not just what you're doing. Has value. It's amazing. It's art. It's beautiful. Anything that you can do. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So time out here. Yeah. Addiction Salon. I'm calling you out right now. You were on the show a few weeks ago. I know you got some heads laying around. Ryan Holmes needs some heads.
Yes.
Right.
Because I mean, they would do well with the man. And like, it's like we do mastership by teaching. And I've had some amazing moments with, you know, a little boy be like, I know how to braid. And the girl's like, that's just a twist. And it's like, well, then show them what the braid is, you know. And then it's them back and forth, the dynamics, the conversations. It's amazing. And I'm learning. I learned so much, man. I learned so much. It's great.
That's what the lady, Miss Betty, she has a podcast called that. Her real name is Sean. She put that you are, you know, teaching leadership through training, you know, Covey called that second person training or teaching. But mastership through teaching, I love that a lot. So I'm gonna keep us moving a little bit. Tomorrow on the show, I've got Duran Robertson, who also runs a company called Barber to Beauty. And Barber to Beauty, we're going to put a call out to him too, because he can get you some heads. It's like gets beauty shops and barber shops into the technology age so they can book online and have more control over COVID and stuff like that. What question would you like me to pass on to him?
You know, with the ever-changing scape, you know, I'm sure you never dreamed that he'd be using technology the way he is in that field. So I guess my question would be, moving forward, where does he see technology taking that business, taking styling and hair, the way we make appointments, the way we think about how we want our hair done, all that? I wonder what he thinks will happen.
All right. So he's going to like that question. I think he thinks, you know, in terms of being a visionary and all of that. But with you, did you think, all right, so 7 years ago, it's a Friday night, you're at the Tin Can and you're doing chalk art here. Did you think you would be using this much technology 7 years later?
No. And I mean, the funny thing is, even a year, we can say, let's go 3 years ago, because 3 years ago, I would have been doing chalk art at the Can, and I would have the same computer that I have that I'm doing this interview and that I do all this stuff off of. And it blows my mind, the amount of effects work and things that I had at my fingertips for so long, and in so many different regards, and in this technical way, but also even the practical maker space. I do a lot of stuff with electronics and circuitry, which now I'm teaching, but I've had great teachers through maker spaces and personal networks that, like yourself and the Fledge, thank you, that have taught me. So I've been able to do more of that and teach more of that to my kids, but I never would have saw that or given myself the time to go through that process. Or I always say, when you have those teachers around all the time, we tend to let those teachers do some of that work, but to really be put by ourselves in this isolation with the social isolation and all that, to really go, okay, now we're stepping up on your own. What can you do? And I think that's another reason why I teach the way I teach, because if we are to go into another isolation or the way that these kids, their dynamic in life is right now, I want them to be just as powerful without me or without anybody else around them. And I want them to really see what they're capable of. I want them to see what they can still create and aspire to be, you know, without, you know, and that you can still seek education without the teachers around. You know what I mean? We're teaching them how to be so able and so apt to get onto this stuff. So where are you going to go? What are you going to look for? You know, what are you going to aspire to do? And if we don't scare them away from anything, and if we show them all these possibilities continuously, whoo, it's crazy, man.
Ryan, you are amazing. What you're doing is so important on so many levels. I could talk to you all day about the creative economy. I could talk to you all day about pathways into all kinds of different jobs. I could talk to you all day about how we cannot escape art, whether it's the design of this computer, how elegant this mic is, or the art that I, or even the cultural art that I keep around.
I'll be back.
I know. But I want to tell you much love for what you're doing for the community, because you're making it stronger. You're making these kids have more opportunity, because I'm sick of seeing them, you know, flipping guns and Percocet and stuff like that and getting hurt and nobody giving them a chance. They walk in here, they meet someone like you, and the whole thing becomes different. And we really need people like you, Ryan, and I appreciate it.
We need people like you too, and places like you. Thank you for the place that you facilitate to allow a person like me to come in and give that leadership to, and to have a safe space, because as an educator, I can't facilitate education unless the kids are safe and taken care of. And when I walked through your doors, the first thing that I noticed was that they were always brought in to be safe. They were always fed. You made sure that there was food around. You always made sure mentally they were taken care of. So we need that. We need that. I'm glad to partner with you in anything that I can do. So thank you so much.
Our relationship is symbiotic. You gave us so much wisdom today. Thank you so much for being on the show, Ryan.
Yeah,
so, you want to take us out with any other favorite quote, deuces? Give a shout out to someone, anything.
Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. So yeah, I thought it's always a little bit of both. So
all right. Thank you so much, Ryan. No problem. I appreciate it. Great show.